Paul is the singer, Peter is the dancer, Jude is the one that is mixing. So it's complimentary. Okay, did I say something?
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so why would you want to consider a limited liability company? I already said it. Separate legal personality is an independent legal entity. It can transact business on its own. It can do whatever it wants to do. It's separated from you. There's perpetual succession. If you decide you don't want to do it again, you want to move on, you want to retire, it will outlive you. Third parties is more attractive to them. Why? Because there are certain regulations that they know you would have to comply with, and they can see a more definitive structure, so to speak. There's a board, there are directors, there are properly corporate governance policies that you'd have to abide by depending on your industry. But the tax is heavier, obviously, because you are doing more. And then it's, depending on the size of your business, more expensive to operate. But if you are running a medium, large-scale company, it's definitely more appropriate. So what are the costs for setting up these structures? A lot of the time, when clients come to me, they think the costs are prohibitive because you think, oh, it's a company, there's so much, I have to really save a lot of money to start my own company. It's not. The costs are actually very reasonable. If you are going to set up a business name, with 10,000 naira, you are good to go. But so that I'm not misunderstood, when I mean the cost for setting up the business, is the cost for registering the business. So that's registering at the Corporate Affairs Commission. I don't mean, like, for instance, if you are going to start maybe a poultry farm, I'm not talking about the cost of buying your chicks or your feed, no. Just the cost for registering. So you can register your business name with 10,000 naira, and you can use a lawyer who obviously is more familiar with the process. You can negotiate fees, or for the business name, you can actually do it on your own. For the limited liability company, this will depend on your share capital. So for instance, if you're going to incorporate a limited company with a share capital of 1 million naira, you would have to register 10,000 naira. Every extra million attracts a fee of 5,000 naira. So if it's 20 million, 15,000 naira. And then you pay stamp duties because they are filing documents, so there are stamp duties on all of that. So for a limited liability company with a share capital of 1 million naira, to register will take you approximately 18,500 naira. That's reasonable. Very. Yes, there are some legal requirements you can't avoid once you started the business. This is actually the part I'm... This is actually what, I mean, I'm really here to guide you. And so you start the business, you have to obtain the licenses. You know the regulators. There will be laws and policies regulating that business. Depending on the business you start, you want to go into food manufacturing or pharmaceuticals or cosmetic sector. You register with the Department of Petroleum Resources. But in every business that you decide, because I think almost every business has some kind of regulator, even small cyber cafes, and stand now, they have to register with the NCC. That's the Nigerian Communications Commission. So you should always check and verify who your regulator is, whether there are any regulations, guidelines, and policies that would apply to you so you don't run foul of the law. So always check for those specific registrations. So what if a non-Nigerian is going to participate in your business? Are there any other things that you need to consider? Yes, with a non-Nigerian, the requirements, there are more requirements. So you can't do it with a business name, first of all, because for a non-Nigerian to participate, they have to take steps to incorporate a company. So you just forget the business name. Then you have to register with the Nigerian Investment Promotion Commission. This really, they are just keeping records of the foreign investments that are flowing into the country. Then you obtain a business permit. It's an approval you need to operate once you are going into business with a foreigner, or a foreigner is coming to set up business. And then if a foreigner is perhaps going to come and work or sending employees to work or persons to train people in the business, you would have to obtain an expatriate quota. The quota is essentially an approval which you get from the Ministry of Interior. So the quota just allows you to employ foreigners. But once you employ those foreigners, you need to get them work permits as well. And then also, some people are not necessarily coming to work, but they are transferring technology. Like a lot of these franchises that you know, they transfer their technology. So if they are bringing in technology and they are coming to train or install some equipment, you may need to register with NOTAP. NOTAP is the National Office for Technology Acquisition and Promotion. And then the foreign investors, how do you pay them? How do you pay a foreigner? You need to get what we call income tax for companies could be either 20% or 30%. 20% for companies that are involved in manufacturing, agriculture, or wholly involved in exporting. And then your turnover must be less than maybe 1 million or less. It doesn't apply to you if your turnover is more. And then it's only you can only do that for 5 years. After 5 years, you graduate to 30%. So generally, the tax on incomes is actually 30% for companies. Now you have education tax for all companies. All companies, 2%. You pay an education tax of 2%. Then there's personal income tax. If you have employees, you have to deduct their personal income tax according to the pay-as-you-earn scheme. So there's a graduated income level. It could be up to 24%. Then there's value-added tax on goods and services, except some that are exempt. Some goods and services are actually exempted from VAT, like your baby products, basic food items, books, academic books. They're all exempt from value-added tax. That's 5%. Then there's the withholding tax. Withholding tax is really like an advance payment on income tax. So it's a strategy of government so that they'll be able to get tax ahead and also identify who should be paying tax. So you as a supplier of service will be required to withhold tax to whoever is invoicing you. So withholding tax will be either 5% to 10%, depending on the transaction and also from whom you are withholding the tax from. So depending on transaction, so for construction, building, it could even be as low as 2.5 in some instances. So yeah. And then there are several state and local government taxes. I'm sure a lot of business owners have experienced that. Once you set up shop, I can assure you, they will come knocking. They will come. You will pay tax for that dustbin that you have outside your shop. You will take tax for that banner that you've hung somewhere. They just come. But you must always verify. Just, was it last week, a client of mine came again. You know, and they said, it was some local government, and they said development levy. You know, they just get all sorts of random ways. They are trying to generate revenue, you know, but you must check with your lawyer. Verify that you are, whether, because some taxes are only exclusive to the federal government. So you might have already paid that tax, and that local government officer is just coming to harass you. Okay, television license, dustbin, this, everything. They will throw it. They will throw the sink at you. But always check with a lawyer, somebody knowledgeable, a tax counselor, to make sure that you are not being shafted. Then there are certain mandatory contributions that you'll be required to make. For there's pensions, there's a contributory pension form that will apply to you, but this is if you have 15 employees and above. So the contribution is a total of 18%. If you are the employer, you pay 10%. The employee pays 18% in fund. of your annual payroll. So you have to deduct this and pay as well. But good enough, if you have evidence that you've provided training to your employees in the course of the year, you would get a 50% refund on that. Then you pay 1% of the monthly payroll, that's to the employee's compensation fund. So I'm sorry, the abbreviations, but I hope everyone remembers it. Then there's 2.5% you also pay to the National Housing Fund. That's 2.5% of the basic salary of your employees. So that seems like a lot, right? It is a lot. But don't be discouraged. You are making a lot of profits. And then it seems like, but don't be discouraged, because if you don't pay, you pay more. The crocodiles are going to get you. There are penalties and there are interest. So let's get it right. We're just starting. So let's get it right. And even if you've not started, you can still get it right. But you can get some things back. Sometimes government decides to give you back something. There's some tax incentives, and well, you would have to be eligible for them. We have a popular one, it's called the pioneer status. And this will typically be given for persons in industries that are considered valuable to the economy. So for instance, you are producing cement or pharmaceuticals or academic text, they will give you pioneer status. And what is pioneer status? It's a tax holiday. It means that you'll be exempted from paying tax on your income for 5 years. But you don't get the 5 years at once. You get 3 years, and then if after 3 years you apply again and they see you should get it, you get another 2 years. So you're on holiday from tax for 5 years. Then for people that are into exports, who manufacture and export, there are several export incentives. There's the duty drawback. So for instance, you're exporting something, you've imported raw materials. And when you import raw materials, you're supposed to pay import duties, right? So you import your raw materials, and then you manufacture whatever it is you want. Then you export it. You can go to government and say, I have exported this. Can I have my duty back? And you get your duty back. So there are several incentives like that that you can take advantage of if you are in the export business. And then there's the public infrastructure and employment relief. This really is a relief that you get when you generate and retain employees at a certain level. And then for the public infrastructure, if you provide infrastructure of a public nature, you would be entitled to this relief. So, for instance, you own a water bottling company and you put a borehole with a tap outside it and the public are able to access it, you'll probably be able to take advantage of this relief. But it's a tenured relief. It was an order given by the government in 2012 and it's for 5 years, so you only have 1 year left, so you can take advantage of it before it's over. So your ideas are all out there. You know, it's no longer in your head, though. It's out there for people to see. You may want to protect your brand, your creativity. You want to protect it. It's one person that started Pure Water Sachet. One person had the idea to put water in a sachet. How many people are doing pure water today? You know the numbers. So depending on what you do, if you have arts, literary work, you can copyright it, your brand, you want to trademark your name, your logo, you know, you go to the trademark registry, have it registered, and you're protected from all those people. It doesn't mean they won't come, but it means that you have in writing law to proceed against them and get judgment against them to stop using your trademark. Then you have inventions, who knows, amongst us here today, somebody may get a cure for cancer. You want to protect that immediately. And then industrial designs, whatever designs you make. For instance, you are producing maybe a particular drink, your bottle, you're producing it on a large scale, you want to protect that bottle. I mean, we know about, I don't know if you followed that Samsung and Apple case. Apple was alleging that Samsung copied their design. So you want to protect it from the word go so that you can lay claim to the benefits on. And then it doesn't stop there. That's the one that I've already mentioned. Excuse me. Throughout the lifetime of the company, You are required to file certain returns. There are certain compliance obligations you would have to do, either annually, biannually, depending on what sector you are operating in. But all companies are required to file annual returns to the CAC. What are your annual returns? It's really just your financial statements, statements from your directors, and then you fill the forms provided from the CAC. Very straightforward. You have to, You have to do tax returns, you know, and pay, so you have to pay your taxes. It's amazing the number of illustrious businesses that don't pay tax. So the other day I went to, ShopRite, Ikeja Shopping Mall, and that was my first time there, so I was just going around all the shops. So I noticed a particular sticker on almost 20 of the shops. So I went closer and I looked at it. They were all notices from the FIRS. All of them were not paying tax. In fact, one of the shops I entered, because I like shopping for household, it was a household shop. So I touched one plate and I said, how much? They said 100K. So in my mind, I said, you are selling cake, you are selling plate for 100K, you have not paid your tax. Okay, no problem. So you have to be very vigilant for your tax, verify how much you need to pay from the word go. There are certain ways of managing your tax burden. Talk to your tax counselors, accountants. And then, depending on the industry you are operating in, again, there may be more filings for you to do, like the NCC, the DPR. Just find out. Make sure you just file it. Because even if you don't do it today, when you finally hammer, and then you want to just blow, you will do it, and you will do it with interest. So, let's get it right from the word go. So, on the appropriate structure, register tax, get your license, start to make the money. Thank you.
Did I go down?
Thank you.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Another round of applause for Ms. Ijoma Uju. I'm not so sure if this was about setting up your business or paying your taxes, but...
You'd have to excuse me. So, you'd have to excuse me. I just noticed something. At the beginning of my slides, I promised to give you guys the frequently asked questions. I just noticed that it was missing from here. So you just excuse me. We'll quickly run through that. I think I have it here. Okay. Yes. So I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have outside of that. So in the course of that, I'll probably run through the questions and answers that we have. Thank you.
Thank you. Right. So we'll have a very quick session of question and answers. And the ushers have question slips, so please, if you have a question, just put up your hand and the ushers will give you a question slip. You can quickly scribble on that and give it back to any of the ushers. If you can't wait for the ushers, just take a piece of paper out of your notepad and scribble on it and hand it over to the ushers. A few house rules, just to let you know. We have conveniences at the back of this building, so if you need to excuse yourself, please use any of the exits to my left and to my right, and use the conveniences at the back of the building. Also, I'd like to let you know that we have exhibition stands for Templars and also for our keynote speaker who will be joining us shortly. The KICC exhibition stand is outside, and the Templars exhibition stand is also outside, so please avail yourself of this opportunity to gather as much information as you require. I would now like to invite our interviewer, a founding member of Covenant Capital. I'd like to invite Mrs. Enobong Ezekiel as she moderates the question and answer sessions.
Hello, Ijoma.
Hello, ma.
Thank you so much. I think I've heard, I know I've started a business, but I kind of think after what you put up. I presume that I need to go check some things myself and ensure that I'm doing the right things, as you have put it up there. But I, before we start having questions from the audience, you know, I wanted to ask, there are quite a few businesses that, you know, are already up and running that haven't exactly gone through all this legal, you know, framework that you have put up here, but they are existing and they are doing business and they have been doing business for years. So what happens? Is there like a regulatory body up? Is there like a tax force up that goes, you know, that has to go, you know, talking to these people or trying to get them to do the right things? Are you involved in anything like that? You know, what do we do to like stabilize that? Because we have a lot of people who have ideas and they just stand up, spring up and start those ideas. Call a sign painter, put up something, but they don't exactly have anything in place. What is your company or you personally doing about that?
Well, is there a regulatory body up? The regulatory bodies have been in existence. The fact that enforcement is not very high doesn't mean that they're not there. The Federal Inland Revenue Service is there. The State Inland Revenue Service is there. The fact that they haven't come yet doesn't mean they're not coming. They probably didn't come because Earl was selling at $100. But now that we're trying to generate more income, they will come and meet you on there. So one day, so they're actually regulatory bodies. They have the mandates to collect those kind of, to collect taxes for you. You might be able to hide in your corner, do business, make outstanding profits. But do you want to stay in that corner forever? Like the theme today says, is owning and growing business. I mean, I'm not talking on that because I don't know what it means. I really don't have the keys for you to succeed at business. But I believe that you don't want to stay in that corner forever. So the moment you decide to come out of that corner, you know, the spotlight is going to be on you. So you are going to be required to do all of those things. So.
Thank you. So just this, a warning. In case you have all those sunny corner, you've been caught. Ijoma has just informed us that there are regulatory bodies and these bodies are out there. And I really do agree. I realized very recently that LASA has been going around. There's been a major rampage, yes, tax force on LASA. People are not even paying for signages. And, you know, they're bringing down, and people are just putting them back up, actually. You know, it's like the sign man is sitting on the corner waiting to just hang it back up, you know. So, okay, thank you, Joma. I was going to also ask, in one of the slides, I think I actually put that down, where you were talking about expansion, you know, to expand, in case you want to expand. What if, you know, because we have infrastructural issues for business owners, you know, entrepreneurs in this country, and you really want to get into that kind of, you know, thing, and you want to expand, but it's so difficult. You have to, like, go back to your lawyers again and want to start going through the process of, okay, what do I do? Must you, like, have a lawyer as your next best friend every time you want to just, like, go your next step in the business? You know, you run back to the lawyer and say, hey, what? How am I covered? What's the next thing to do? You know, must that always happen?
Well, not necessarily what is advisable, especially if it's
for the lawyers.
And it's advisable because when you're expanding, it means, I mean, your obligations will be increasing. And at that point of expansion, you may not know what your obligations are. You're expanding, it means you're probably bringing on more business partners. You're entering into more contracts, getting more service providers. You want your lawyers to look over all of this. So, yes, your lawyer should be your next best friend. Yes.
Well, please know that when you're writing your business plan and you get to the cash flow statement, try and have a spot for the lawyer and double the fees if you have to. It's very important if your lawyer. Okay, well, I have a question. If someone uses your product design, where will be the appropriate quarter to which report such cases?
Yeah, well, if someone uses product design, And depending on the products, you can go back to the trademark registry and report it. It's not yours, but if you registered it, you have a right in law. So you can go back either to the regulators, maybe the person is using it and is on the shelves. Let's say, for instance, the person is selling something, food product. You can go to NAFDAC and report the person. There are cases where NAFDAC will not register that person. Or if all else fails, you just take the person to court and deal with it there, and the court will decide in your favor if you have evidence that you have the rights and ownership to that product design.
Well, we have seen cases where sometimes these things just drag on in the courts. We don't want to call names because, quite a few of them are keeps going on. And inside that, you know what, both parties, nobody's using this design at all. But it was originally someone's creation. So because you didn't register it, you just have to let it go. That's what you're saying.
Yes. The law will only afford you the protection of evidence that you had the design and you were first in time.
Avoid double taxation, importantly in states. We have that a lot. Is it doing job properly when it comes to, you know, properly registered? You know, and then they come back again and tell you there's no record of, you know, you having paid taxes before. How do you avoid double taxation?
Well, first of all, after you register and when you start paying taxes, you have to keep very, very good records of the taxes that you've paid, because the taxes are very, very clear. Taxes are transparent. Your legal advisor or a tax advisor. If you have any issues, comes again, because everybody's trying to generate, at the federal level, they're trying to generate revenue, states as well. So the states will come. States are entitled to. You'll be surprised that they are actually law. Some frivolous, yes. So this is where you need your lawyer to tell you, oh, this shouldn't be, we can challenge it. Even some of them that exclusive to the federal government, so the state cannot manufacture it just because you are working in the state. That that tax.
I like this question. Having worked in the financial industry at some point, we used to have a lot of issues. So I really like this question, and I would really like to hear your answer on this one. Is it advisable for one to use his wife and children, or husband and children, as board of directors in one's business? I'm sure the audience, there are many people who want to hear what you have to
say.
That
is a very interesting question. And incidentally, it was actually on my frequently asked questions. Is it advisable? Well, maybe I should rephrase the question, because advisable, I really don't know your family matter. Let me rephrase it. Can you? Yes, you can use your husband or your wife or any other family member as your board of directors or as your shareholders in your company. If so, that's below 18, that person cannot be a director. But your child below 18 can be a shareholder if there are two adults also shareholders. So yourself and your wife and even your six-month-old baby can be shareholders in the company. Whether it's advisable, I don't know.
Okay, now that now becomes a personal matter.
Yes.
You need to go and consult with the Holy Spirit, right, at some point to tell you whether it's okay to use your wife or your children or your husband. Okay, someone is quite frightened and needs to know. All the taxes you mentioned, the education tax, the income tax, VAT, VAT, does it apply to the business names as well?
No, not all of them.
Not
in fact,
all
most
of
them don't apply.
Because I know there are quite a number of business people that, people look at it and they say.
For the business name, you know, I made the point that it's you are the business, you are the sole proprietor. So you are, and if there are more, is there if there's more than one proprietor, all they are paying is you pay tax on the income that you have apportioned your local government, your VAT, and all of that. But education tax, no, it's not applicable to you. So you just pay tax on your income as an individual.
Okay, so don't get frightened, business name owners. Because I know a lot of people must be like, when I finish paying all this one, where will I get money to pay salaries and pay, you know, some other things? So don't get frightened. Ijoma has bailed us out. Okay, someone wants to know, does patency really work in Nigeria? We know that internationally, you know, those rights are, you know, but does it really work in Nigeria? Because I have actually... No, I'm sure. I mean, you've set up to over 200 businesses and all that. So I'm sure you've come across, you know, some things that have really been...
Some requirements you know, they won't just register requirements that have been prescribed. There's a law governing patents. So you would need to fulfill some requirements. So you can imagine someone just comes tomorrow and I have the cure for patents to certain. It's subject video, but once it goes through and it is ascertained, yes, this is indeed some invention and it came from box. Trust me,
it works. God bless Nigeria. Things are working. Someone wants to know, could you please explain more on withholding tax? This person is very pained. He says that we did a couple of projects for a company. On every purchase order, they withheld 5%. How do they now remit withholding tax to FIRS? I mean, the company held 5%. How do they now remit the withholding tax to FIRS?
Who is just to understand, is it... company that is withholding?
Yes, they did a project for a company, and for every purchase order, the company withheld 5%.
Yes. That company...
So you're saying now that the company that withheld 5% will pay. They also will pay. So we are saying two companies are paying to FIRS.
No.
That's the clarification.
Okay, thank you. So the company that withheld the tax... that the company to whom the service was provided is obliged to withhold tax. So it pays that to the FIRS. So if you, as a company, you are also obliged to withhold tax on whatever transactions or services for people. So it could be 5%. I'm sure the is probably an individual limited liability company, it would probably be 10%. So whoever withheld that, you as that company go to the FIRS, you are going with documents showing that this has been withheld from this transaction. So when you are filing your returns, you say, oh, this tax has already... So what happens is that it has been removed. We are not going to pay 10%. And okay. Like I said, it's an advance tax on income tax.
I hope the person asked the question. Price to a limited liability company?
If you want to change your business name, the procedure is quite straightforward. You just, because everything is done at the Corporate Affairs Commission, so you just look for the name. If you are using the same name, obviously you already own that name because on your records of the CAC, you are the owner. So you just get the required documents and file them that you want to be a limited liability company. So you get your incorporation documents. But if you are changing to a different name, you probably have to file and find out that that name is available. So you check if the name is available, then you can as well, you go on, you reserve it, you get your incorporation documents, and you file. You are a business name. Straightforward process. I mean, you are a limited company. Straightforward process.
Straightforward.
Yeah. Very straightforward.
The whole process can be concluded?
It can be concluded in a week or two. Some people may disagree, but I have done it for my clients in a week or two. But obviously, you have to give room for administrative delays.
Do you do pro bono work? I just wanted to chip that
let's
in.
Let's talk after this.
Okay. This is another question I like. I don't understand it, but I need you to answer.
Okay.
if your business is on pause, am I required to pay tax?
Well, when you
I
say
really, okay. on pause, I really need to understand what does yeah. that mean.
Well, my understanding is that you are not doing business in that in the interim. So tax, you pay tax on income. So if your business is on pause, that means you're not generating income, right? So you're not, you're only paying tax on what you make. So if your business is on pause, you may not be, you will not be required to pay tax, but depending on, you have to show the authorities that yes, it is indeed on pause. If you've seen that you've done any kind of transaction, then no. But they are still setting other taxes. And I mean, if you are doing other transactions in the meantime, because the tax is on your global income. So there's no restriction. But if you are saying it's on pause and the tax authorities look and they see, oh, there's no income generation, there's nothing for them to tax.
Is there a regulatory infraction against the company? Who is it?
For regulation, is the what are they? They are they like directors. They direct the company. So if there's a regulatory infraction, in some cases they would come against the director because they are seen as the directing forces of that company. So they won't just go against penalized for infractions of the company because they should have known better.
Thank you. I think we have
room
for one last question.
Would you please provide that could help businesses learn legal issues properly? That's the only one I know. Especially with respect to the Nigerian situation. Are there websites they can go? Are there books they can, read or, that would explain this a lot more for them until they can... call you.
Yes, there are a lot of resources out there. Well, I mean, I'll refer you to Template's website. I think there's a stand outside. You'll get the website name. We actually have, if you go through the site, we have information on doing business in Nigeria, which will be up on the site. And there are various other sites. You can actually go to the Corporate Affairs Commission site, and there are a lot of company law texts that have been written to aid your understanding. A popular one is Sasegun, and there's Orojo. But if you, once you just go on the internet, you can just Google doing business in Nigeria. And a lot of audit firms like your KPMG and PwC's, they always release annual reports on doing business. So things may have changed.
It would not have been. Bijoma did not. Okay. I'm being told that I can actually continue. I'm
okay.
Asking questions. So, and you have a lot to answer, Ijoma.
Oh, my God.
Should I get you your water?
I'm fine.
You're fine. Okay. All right. Are there incentives for those importing agricultural equipment, like mobile fish ponds? I didn't ask the question.
Well, I'm not sure specifically. But if you are importing the mobile fish ponds and there is some benefits that can be derived, you are importing the mobile fish pond and you have generated or you've, what's that word they use in fish agriculture? You've made enough and you are exporting, then yes, there's an incentive for you. But the fact that you just imported it into the country, you have to show there's some benefits. So if you can show there's some benefits, you may have some duty waivers on that import.
So how do they get around to getting these incentives?
Yeah.
Is it from the, like you gave us a list, the status and all that. So they have to go looking.
Yeah, you have like the pioneer status, you go to the NIPC, and then the tax incentives, it's when the tax, when you're assessing yourself, you put in all those things that you've done, and then you assess it, and when the tax man comes, they say, okay, I'm entitled to this because I've done this, and you get those reliefs.
But let me ask you this before we go to another question. Is it that a lot of Nigerians, indigenous businesses specifically, are not aware that they have, you know, access to these incentives? Because over time, I have realized that you have more of the foreign businesses that actually access. I don't really get to see enough, you know, indigenous businesses actually claim what their, quote unquote, what is their right. Is it that we don't, it's not, you know, the awareness, you know, on these incentives is not, you know, accessible, or people just don't want to bother about, you know, getting this information and actually, because the incentives become some sort of relief. Yeah. For their businesses. So why, what in your own opinion, why do you think indigenous businesses, you know, do not, you know, look forward to actually assessing these incentives that is, in my own opinion, their rights?
These incentives, first of all, they are eligibility requirements. And on the face of it, it might just look, oh, there are these incentives and I can just go just because I'm doing this business. But there are certain eligibility requirements. So yes, I don't believe that a serious business person wouldn't have looked for somewhere to get some kind of relief or cut off or eligible, yes, or things that you need to fulfill to be eligible. Or those incentives actually don't apply to your kind of business. So yes, those incentives are there, but they apply to certain kinds of business. And honestly, so far, the indigenous businesses that I advise, they always are aware. A serious business owner is always looking for how to retain his profits. So more, they are always aware. So unless those ones you are talking about want to hide away, maybe they are not even paying their taxes properly, so they won't want to access it. So what's happening is that they are getting more relief from not paying. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Makes a lot of sense. Okay. Another question. How do very small businesses, we're doing businesses are almost like saying, do you do pro bono work?
We actually organize seminars and try to reach out to small businesses. We have a lot of small and medium businesses that we've helped along the way. So, and when you say very small, when you are a very small business, at that point, you probably don't need to take a loan that you can't pay. Yes, we do organize all those services, legal service, advice, your fee requirements. So we always try to adjust our costs. So I will not charge you the same fee. I will charge a large multinational. Fees are always negotiable. So don't be scared.
Don't be afraid. We're on the faith walk. Take a leap of faith. Take a leap of faith and come see Joma, you know, so that you can access legal services. Okay, if I have a foreign direct,
even though he's not resident, what the requirement is, he's participating in the business. So once you are participating in business, you have taken up shares in that business, then yes, you're required to register with the NIPC and get the permits that are applicable to businesses that have foreign participation. So it's really just your business permit and register with NIPC. Now, if that person is going to come and reside and wants to work, then you have to take a step further and get an expatriate quota and the relevant work permits.
Thank you, Joma. Please, can you explain FACTA? I'm sure you know the...
I know what it is, but I'm going to plead the fifth on that one. I can't explain it. I'm still trying to understand this myself.
Okay, Jama, just plead the fifth. I can't explain it. I mean, even Jama can't. It's not me that plans on even trying, you know, to answer that question. We're still waiting for a few more questions to come in, but I'll ask this question while we're waiting. So we have a limited liability company that is running. We have, with partners and all. Mm-hmm. And then there is some sort of internal squabble, some sort of internal breakup, but mm-hmm. one party doesn't want to leave, one party insists on staying. Mm-hmm. From a legal perspective, how would you handle that? One party has gone ahead and brought in their partners and says, you know what, I want this, you know, partnership dissolved, but the other person is not willing to go. Maybe the other party is, you know, what you call the intellectual property. Yeah. And how do you deal with that legally?
Yeah, you mentioned limited liability companies. It's actually easier. So you would have challenges with those kind of squabbles if you have partnerships. So you have I've seen partnerships where people just come together and down the line they find out they are not business compatible. You can be your best friend or even your girlfriend or your wife and you find they are not business compatible. So what I always advise people, first, from the word go, you should always have a very, very comprehensive partnership agreement. And your partnership agreement should always state terms of course to know how to deal with it. But if you've already started and for some reason you don't have your partnership, partnership agreements amicably resolved. Otherwise, your final arbiter would have to be the courts. But with partnerships, it's always very advisable from the start, get your partnership agreement. I agree, that person can be your best friend, but in my state, how it all the difference is this for copyright.
And I want to believe that presentation we just heard, and we that her services can be negotiable. For someone who has, you know, dealt with over 200 startups, I would advise that to come this way. Don't go and look at us somewhere at the backside of Boyle Street at Unico.
You're not smiling like people that are excited. As if you are baptized with now I think because I have the privilege to introduce someone I've always admired from a distance. Now I know you understand what I'm talking about and you wish you are the one doing this introduction. Don't worry. No man taketh this honor upon himself. Pastor Matthew Ashimolowo is around. Okay. I thought you were going to scream a little more. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Remember when I did my introductory speech, I said the highlight of this meeting is that we don't just have a businessman coming to talk to us. We have both a businessman, a prophet, and a priest. And when you mix those three together, those that know what I'm feeling understand already. So I'll be quick to do this and go and sit down and take my notes. Pastor Matthew Ashimolowo is the founder and CEO of about 10 profitable companies, which include a global TV station, KICC TV. He is also the founder of Kingsway International Christian Center, a Christian charity with a global footprint in 214 nations via television, with a volunteer base of over 1,000 staff. His weekly telecast, Winning Ways, is a source of inspiration and motivation to many. The author of 87 books, including The Power of Positive Prayer Bible, and the classic, What's Wrong with Being Black? A book hailed for reaching the parts communities campaigners cannot reach. His philanthropic work in the community has been given recognition as one of 5,000 invited to carry the Queen's Golden Jubilee Celebration torch. He has been honored several times as the most influential black person in the public sector religious category by The Power List, a unique publication that profiles and celebrates the most influential black people. Pastor Matthew, one of the most today, and it's with great trembling and privilege that I bring up to the stage Pastor Matthew Ashimolowo.
May I just ask that we pray for 1 minute? Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege of and honor of being here together this morning. Thank you for all the speakers and their contribution in helping us find our paths, our destiny in the world of business. Bless us in this next session. Let the entrance of your word bring light and understanding. To you be all glory and praise, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. It's such a great honor and privilege to be asked to come and share with you this morning, and it's my sincere hope and prayer that in the brevity of the time that I have, I'll be able to make an impact, share with you something that will launch you on the road to success and the road to financial liberty, financial breakthrough, your own company doing well and achieving greatness in the name of Jesus. It is very interesting that today in the church, we're sharing about company formation, how to run your business, and how to increase capacity. The church has gone through several paradigms. And part of the paradigm has been teachings that have actually limited us and kept us in a very small place. When I got born, if you came to church, there might be people who managed to have a car. So you dare offend him. He was the only car owner in the church. Our idea, our thoughts was just to away, except makes true the joke I just read recently of two banknotes. One was a 1,000 naira note. About to be cut to pieces because they've traveled around the nation. They are now worn out. And the conversation came out, broke out between the two of them. The nice hotels. And then he turned to the 10 naira note and said, how about you? Where have you been? Said, churches. Redeem, Mountain of Fire, KRCC, Covenant Christian Center. But I think the paradigm is changing. In 1989, 1990, books that were written by people like Dr. Kenneth Hagin, Dr. Kenneth Copeland, Fred Price began to come into our country, and we had, may I say, a different dimension to the subject of finance, and that has been the wave. Of course, with every good thing, sometimes there's imbalance, but we must listen. Everything is our own business. Verses 1 to 14, you have God's template for blessing his people as they entered Canaan. Deuteronomy 28 was actually read on Mount Gerizim from verse 1 to 14. And verse 15 to 64 or thereabout was read on Mount Ebal. So there was a mountain of blessing and there was a mountain of curse or cursing. When you look at Deuteronomy 28, verse 1 to 14, it makes mention of three kinds of platforms of increase. The first one is God says he will bless the work of your hand. Bless your basket. And then the third is that God says he will bless your storehouse. And when you look at the majority of people in church, level, which is salary. A good world evangelism, but the teaching of the church in the past has kept us in the place where we only accessed the level of work of hand. And I believe the reason you are here today is the basket stands for the essence. In a nutshell, it is showing us the fact that while God has so much he wants to bless you with, he cannot give you all the water in this bottle if you brought a the container you brought is full. What happens to the rest? It's wasted away. That is exactly the challenge in the church. There's so many gifted people in the church. In fact, we are the most blessed. On top of, I believe Nigeria being in the to happen in the world. I think somebody should say amen. Yeah. We also are believers. We have the Holy Spirit. We have an extra step beyond the unsaved person. We have the leading of the Holy Spirit. We can hear God. But if you bring a container that's too small, work of hand, you limit what God can pour into your hand. So the second level is the SME, the small and medium enterprise. The third, God said he will bless your storehouse. I take storehouse breakthrough to be when you become an employer or somewhere around 30, 50 to 1,000 or thousands of people. And I tell you, somebody had said, no matter what, every nation listens to the people in whose hand the wealth is. God wants to put it in your hands because the world needs to hear the gospel. Now I'm going to give you 30 reasons why you ought to start your own company. And I mean, even though I came in just as the last speaker was answering questions, the areas of our expertise I'm not going to touch too much so that I don't get myself into trouble myself, you know what I'm saying? So the number one reason why you should start your own company is for tax efficiency. And by that, I mean that you ought to start a company which gives you the opportunity to achieve so much with the platform you have created. If you don't, you will find that much of your income goes to the tax man. You are taxed 4 times in your life. When you make money, you will be taxed. When you save money, the bank deducts tax for the government. When you spend money, VAT is charged. And when you die, they come for inheritance tax on the properties you own. So they charge you 4 times. You've got to understand how governments operate, whether it is Nigeria or America. Governments are Indiana Jones and the raiders of the cookie jar. They raid the cookie jar of the people, take from them, and say they are using it for the people. There's nothing wrong with you paying tax. It's our civil responsibility. However, being tax efficient is not a crime. It is tax evasion that is a crime. When you're trying to evade it and not pay, then you are a criminal. But when you are efficient with the money you've made so that you are able to use it, I don't want to go into much details on that, number one. Maybe in the process of sharing, you'll see what I mean again by tax efficiency. Number two, the creation of your own company provides protection against liabilities. In other words, when you have a company, if somebody really wants to fight you, they, in most cases, cannot touch what's in your limited liability company because that company is an entity in itself, just as you are an entity. But you see, there's something about us Africans. We love everything to bear our names. We build houses, we put our full name, Matthew Abiodun Atandaolubunmi Asimolowo. But we do not realize that that's dangerous. If you really want to fight me, all you need to do is one, either just Google or get a forensic accountant and they'll know all the properties I own. And then you can fight me well. But if it's in a company and it's not in my name, you will need to know the company, one. You will need to establish that I'm a director, two. You need to establish that I have holding in the place, three. That's a lot of steps to go through. So when you start a company, it helps you and protects your levels of liability. Number three, reduction of personal liabilities when you form a limited liability company. It sounds a little similar to number two, but you are a human entity. Your company is a legal entity. So what could have been taken from me will be reduced if some of it is in my company. So as I stand before you today, I don't own a house in Nigeria. I don't. I actually am a tenant in a house belonging to a company. I don't. I'm a tenant there, and I deliberately actually pay rent to the company so that I'm not just taking advantage, and it's not just looking nice outside. What that does is, by the grace of God, I'm going to live long. But if I pass on, There is no inheritance tax yet, because the properties don't belong to me. They belong to a company in which actually my wife is a director and one of my sons is a director. So it goes on as a going concern. That way you keep wealth in your house. I may jump all around in my teaching. But let me tell you, that is one of the reasons. What I'm sharing in this 1 hour is a 20-something year journey. I've had to write like 10 books on finance alone. This subject I'm teaching today is an e-book which you'll be able to download and becomes my number 100 book. The journey has meant that 4 years that I've, and I can only think of two families that have perpetuated more than four generations of wealth. Only two. Dantata family are the ones who also gave a loan to Dangote. So apart from that, and maybe one or two here and there, you'll find that many times, many of our wealthy men, either that the wealth died with them, or they gave it to their son, I'm jumping now, who is the firstborn, but not the first able. I'm messing up all my notes, but we'll get somewhere. Which says, to you, if you own a business and you want to pass it to your children, it should not go to firstborn because he is firstborn. It should go to the first able. Or else, bye-bye to that business. The fourth principle here, or the fourth reason, is that you are able to create greater space and volume when you run a business that is through a company. There are people who want to do business, and many are here today. They'll fly to Dubai, they'll buy clothes, they'll park in the car park of the church, and they'll open the car booth and invite various sisters. That's great, that's a start. But you need space, you need volume. Part of the reasons why many of the businesses in our community are not doing well and don't have global footprint is because of the lack of space and volume. And of course, from the principles that were shared today, coupled with some of the things today, there are so many good books in Nigeria, but many of our authors don't know how to create volume. They don't know how to market their books. In fact, many times I'll come and I'll just deliberately go to a Nigerian Christian bookstore because I want to buy Nigerian authors. There is a perspective, there is a dimension, there is a worldview they bring to certain subjects that Americans can't catch it. Because for us, it's not theory. We've been there, we've done that, we have the T-shirt. So you need a company. You need your own business to be able to create volume and to be able to create space. How do I explain this volume and space? When I was a bachelor pastor, I was put in a face me, I face you house in Shomolu by the Four Square Church. The house had 10 rooms, one toilet, one bathroom. So you have to wake early to have your shower, or you'll be late for work because there was limited space. Every morning there was a fight. Baba Mfon is fighting Mama Mukaila. Argument, if you went to the bathroom, how long do you want to take your bath? You want to become Oyinbo? You use the toilet, you dey bump pikin. Then I moved out of that bedroom house with three used today. That is space. Then volume has to do with the amount of capacity The challenge many times is that there is a lack of capacity with many of our businesses. And that a year, I do Ivory Coast now twice a year. I do the rest of Africa here and there. I do like 12 African nations. You will see some Nigerian things creeping into the rest of Africa, but nobody is producing with volume. In case you do not know, one of the benefits, one of the things we enjoyed in Nigeria is that the colonial master did not take our traditional clothes. If you go below West Africa, from the child in the cradle to the woman close to the grave, they all wear gowns, shirts, and ties. They have no traditional clothes. So they crave for Nigerian clothing. So when they finally get to see a few, they grab it. But no Nigerian, everybody wants to go to Europe. They look at the clothes with disdain, and hear the name Nigerian 419. Volume and space. Number five, is it? The possibility of global impact. So I've shared a little bit about that. You need to realize the world has become a global village, and there is a possibility of you being able to take your business to a global level. You'll be able to go beyond your immediate vicinity. Some businesses, unfortunately, at the moment, it is more of the conglomerates, the big names. So you have Dangote Cement. I was in Lusaka last year, and as I'm driving along the road, I'm seeing Dangote Cement. And so on. But you see, we need our businesses, even if it's clothing, we need to begin to think global impact. We need to begin to think global platform. So a company gives you that opportunity. It's no use being a great designer in a corner of Surulere, and people see your clothes once in a while somewhere, but you have no global presence. You don't even have a website. I remember some Nigerian tailor shows up in England, not one on me. He was at this program. He walked up to me and said, "Sir, I brought a parcel for you." When I opened, he had three attires there. And when I opened, he said, "One's free, the other two." He put an invoice there. Then he put a brochure showing some of my friends whom he sews for, and a few big names in town whom he sews for. His design was, "Knock your socks off. I mean, out of this world." This is my first time of wearing English to come to preach here. Because every time I'm in Nigeria, I no longer do this tie thing. I don't want to be tied up at all. His clothes are just out of this world. So here I am, and the clothes came into my hand 2 days before going to Maryland, USA, to preach for the junior brother of the Mommy G of Redeem. I said, "Who is your tailor?" Well, you see, he had no website, but incredible design. Nigerians are gifted, and we're going to change the world. Yeah. Number six, a company helps to concentrate your effort through a legal entity. In other words, at some point, as your company grows, you're going to be having all kinds of things come up, either expansion or entering other nations, or people who have attitude towards you. If it's not through a company, they can pick on you easily and eat you for breakfast. But because it's a company, then you have a legal entity to handle them, to deal with them, to know how to manage them. That separation is so important. And I know from personal experience, I have a particular building. We have like 29 corporate tenants in it. And we've had one or two people who will think, "We don't want to pay rent, and we're looking for if they take you to a court, because somebody will want to use and say, you know, man of God, country hard, you know, this rent thing. Or else you will have issues with people on a rush because of the brevity of time. Because of the brevity of time. Number seven, this is one place where you cannot be sacked. You have a permanent job. You have security as long as the company is viable. In other words, today's world has changed. There's a new words showed up in the outsourcing and early retirement. So these three words have meant that people are now downsizing in companies, and you can be downsized at the age of 35 or 40. You can, the business can be outsourced. The project can be given to another company, because now the owners of the company or the shareholders are more after profit. That's why you find some of the IT works of the United States of America will be uploaded for people in India to do, because they are paid lesser. And when India finishes and they send it to America, America wakes up to find that the work had been done. The world has changed. But if it's your own company, it's yours. If it is viable, no one can sack you. Of course, there are other implications, there are other challenges. At some point, it becomes not be sacked. It's your business. Number eight, anonymity. And let me quickly drop one or two words here. Believers and Nigerians, we tend to be lazy with names of our companies. Your name is Chinedu Osuwa, and you call your company Chisco Limited. We all know who's the owner. You know, the moment we see Chisco, you know, Ade and Ade Limited, we need to be creative. If you look outside, there's Brown Leaf. So Brown Leaf Investment, you know. Yeah, it's a beautiful name. If you look, can you feel some fresh air securities, you know? It's cool, it sounds beautiful. You know, creativity is not nuclear physics. You need to allow your company to give you some degree of anonymity, so that even as the company becomes so big, people can only associate you with it because you chose to want to be associated with it. Anonymity helps so that a person who is a gold digger cannot easily target you. Because there are gold diggers, in case you don't know. There are tenants in this city who, after they've not paid your rent for 2-3 years, they'll pack some load and go out, leave some inside, waiting for you to try to pack the remaining. If you do, there's a Lagos state law that says you are in contempt, and actually you can be jailed for your own house. Anonymity. Number nine, companies help you in the raising of capital. If I walk to a bank, if I was just Joe Blocks on the street, and I said, hello, GTB, hello, Zenith, please, I need a loan of 20 million naira, they will not even consider me that much. But if I have a company that has grown to a certain level and has some equity in it, they know they can tie the loan to it. Now, there are some preachers who will tell you never borrow. I agree. There are scriptures that says we should not borrow and owe no man anything but love. But there is a level of business you can never do if you do not access OPM, other people's money. If they give you the contract to repair Lagos Ibadan Expressway, and it's going to cost 5 to 10 billion naira, even if you had the money, wisdom requires that you don't touch yours, you borrow from the bank. That way, the liability is shared between you and the bank. Bank will be making sure the work is done. You will be making sure the work is done. Part of the reason why a good number of big family businesses died in Nigeria is the absence of dilution. They were not diluted. They just wanted to, it's our family business. It's great to have family business, but if there's no dilution, the chances are that you expose yourself to greater danger. So, raising capital is what a company can do for you, particularly if it's a thriving company, if it is doing well. We know, banks are risk averse. they are risk averse. But at the same time, if they can see some degree of equity in your business and they can see where your business can go from good to great, they would want to work with you. Number. And by the way, talking about raising capital, there are some of the big conglomerates we know in this nation, and we make so much noise about, and we do not even realize that probably 60-70% of their running cost is being carried by the banks. In fact, the banks are on their knees every morning. That company must not go down. Number 10. A company is a separate legal entity. I think I had mentioned this earlier, and I'm very sure that our sister did a better job than I could ever do in the remit of law. You and your small business corporation, charitable organization, or trust which you form are separate legal entities. I have a problem every time I come to Nigeria, particularly because sometimes we've seen abuse. Some people in Nigeria do not realize that KICC is not me, and I am not KICC. Whatever belongs to KICC belongs to KICC. Whatever belongs to me belongs to me. I had that understanding from the beginning. So that even in our church premises in England, I rented space for Matthew Ashimolo Media Ministry books before I had an attack by the charity commissions. So by the time they came, it was as if God was just teaching me, you are too exposed, you are too big in this nation, they are noticing you, put all legal frameworks in place. So a separate legal entity means in effect that your company is a legal entity and you are a human entity. And if anybody touches your company, except for certain situations, they may not be able to touch you. And if anybody touches you, they may not be able to touch the company. That's why you find some. Take advantage of the mind, an extension of the kingdom of God. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 6, God says that in the last days, we are coming with camels that are loaded. We are coming with loaded camels carrying diamonds, carrying properties, carrying favors, carrying blessings. But God also checks the heart to be sure you are able to carry. Number 11. The ownership of a company means you can determine your own day off, not having to apply to anyone. So when you own your own business, it means you can determine when you work or when you don't work. So, but with your own company, you're able to determine when you work. Number 12, you're your own boss, controlling your own destiny and how you run your life. So when you have a lead, when you have a business, it gives you the opportunity to dream, to do things, to extend your life, to control your destiny. Nothing wrong with working with and working for other people. But by you being here today, it means you want to up the game. You want to own something. These are the advantages. These are the reasons. Number 13, a personal company means a better life, car, vacation, because the company pays for it. What does this mean? Right now, if you are a person on a salary, we know how much you earn. Therefore, we know what kind of car you should drive and what kind of house you should live in. Although Nigeria is quite an interesting place, you find that the man's rent is more than his annual salary. But when you own your own company, you are able to determine your own future. You are able to create a lifestyle that is in agreement with your income. And guess what I meant by that point there? The company pays for it. In a properly set up company, which I believe our sister had given us so much information on, you might just find that you are on vacation and you're also working. So, and the company pays for the ticket. Of course, I'm working by Malibu Beach. You know, I'm working on the beachfront of Kingston, Jamaica. Many people have found that owning their own company, they now carry lesser burden of tax. You've got to understand, I keep talking tax, because I can see the horizon and Nigeria is beginning to wake up. Big tax is coming.
In fact, we will reach a point where all those friends of yours who helped to route 1 million through your accounts, by me sorry pass through accounting, by me send the malagwaja, it shall be regarded as your income, and you shall pay 40% of it. Yeah, because after a certain level, tax goes beyond 25% to 40% to 60% to 65%. I pay 40% tax in England. 40%, man. 40%. You know, Nigeria's taxation system is beginning to wake up. It's beginning to wake up, and that's why when you own your own company, several things you do in your name can be done in the name of the company. I don't own a car. The car belongs to the company. I don't own a house. The house belongs to the company. I don't. Number 14, a company gives you a sense of ownership, destiny, and the things which you use the company to buy. So there's a sense of ownership when you start your own business. There's a sense of ownership. You can give more time. You can be more creative. You can put all your energy. Nigerians have a bad philosophy when it comes to working for other people, or particularly working for government. When you work hard, somebody will say, "Now your papa work." Sometimes if you work hard, somebody will say, "Ah, why do you... Are you the mad here? Manager's son?" You know, Obey says, "I love my manager." But when it's yours, you can put all of your strength. There's really technically no closing hour when it's your own business. And you're excited that it's growing and that you're able to create platforms and employ other people. Number 15, you are able to build equity into your future through a company. Able to build equity into your future and even into the future of your children. If you work in Ministry of Works, if you work in PHCN, at the end of your service years, the only thing you are entitled to is a pension. No equity. Your children can't go there and say, "Where's my father's seat?" and occupy. But if it's your own business, you can build so much equity into it. Because you are, in fact, I may not get to all those points, so let me share them now. When you build a business, you find yourself putting yourself under a lesser salary than you would have done somewhere else. Because you want more capital put into it so it can grow, it can become great, and it can become a company that has properties, that has finance, that has capacity. That's what I think believes in of. And open up and start their own business. Because you will be amazed. I heard them talking about patent and copyright. Nigeria is one place where at work they'll give you jobs to do something that might end up in you creating something that should have been a copyright. But your employers will not even talk about it. It's theirs. Number two, in case you don't know, employment law technically, says that if you write a book in the remit of your profession, if you are working for me, the book does not belong to you. It doesn't belong to you. When I had an attack by the British government, they wanted to take my books. I said, Nibu. I had to fight for the copyrights of my books. He said, because you are the head of a charity, and it's the subject that you preach in the charity, and therefore one, no way, man. This one belongs to my children and my grandchildren. But you see, if you do not fight for it, somebody will take it from you. Many people find that at retirement, they have to now cut down their lifestyles because they had no equity built into the future. No equity. And that's why you now find this mother, this papa, this uncle, going from one cousin to the other, one nephew, and say, "Joe, you know, you want to adagba? Can I see 50,000 there? It shall not be your portion." Yeah. I said, "It will not be your portion." Yeah. Number 16, the formation of a company is something of great value, which be believe your legacy be a company and still running by somebody's name. Institutions in somebody's acres of land and a few dollars. started. His name was John Hubbard. He started Harvard University with 5 acres and a few dollars. So God wants you to leave an equity, to leave a legacy, to leave a testimony. A good name is worth more than silver or gold. Number 17, you can pass a company to your children. You cannot pass your employment to them. Selah. That one needs no explanation. You can't pass your employment to your children. But a company can go on in the family as long as you create a cycle of managing it. In one of my books, I wrote how to create 8 cycles of how to generate wealth and the 8 cycles to make it happen. Number 18, a business will keep producing even in your golden years. Blue Arrow, the largest employment agency in the United Kingdom, said there are 2-year employees, there are 5-year employees, and there are 10-year employees. 2-year employees are people who, after 2 years, they are spending time and collecting salary from you. They add no value. And even if you train, some people just do not catch it. There are 5-year employees and there are 10-year employees. But where you have your own business, you don't need somebody to tell you that after 5 years you've passed your worth. You can go on in your golden years and still achieve more. Amen. Last year, the man who won the Nobel Prize for Physics was 84 years old. I will say the city where he lectured must have retired him, because he was a professor, must have retired him maximum at 70. And they would have thought he's reached his apogee, his finality. But 14 years later, he breaks a new field in physics. 14 years later. When you own your own company, even in your older age, in fact, by that time, you've made all your mistakes. You are now making the thing prosper. You are seeing how to create trusts for your grandchildren. That's my kind of vision. Creating trusts for my grandchildren. So that by the time my children I've made provision for the next generation. Fulfilling Proverbs 13:22. A righteous man leaves an inheritance for who? That's what a company helps you to do. Not the one which you are struggling to get in. Every day, massive business is done in Nigeria. Every day, foreigners are coming and shipping away large sums of money. Unbelievable amount. I was in South Africa September 2010 or 2011. And in the newspaper, South African Times, I think it was, MTN was declaring its Nigerian profit for 2010 to be $4 billion. $4 billion. Made from this nation alone. This is your country. The world wants to hear from you. You have creativity. You have things you can make, the things you can sell. You have ideas. You have service you can give, because it doesn't have to be things we make. It can be the service industry. It can be the creative industry. Number 19. A job pays you monthly, but the ownership of a company means you are paid for years to come from your own company, from your own business. But a job, it is a monthly salary that you have to depend on. You know, our people do business. If they don't do business, it's very difficult to survive Nigeria. You just imagine some of those states where the staff have not been paid for 6 months. 9 months. How did they survive? Of course, when they close, they have oranges they sell in front of the house. If it were not that, some systems, some local government, some state governments would have run some people crazy. So a business helps you to be able to have income that is not necessarily a month end, you know, a month end thing. It's a continuous flow, and it depends on the river and streams you have created. That Isaiah chapter 60 verse 6, which I quoted in the NIV, it calls it streams. It says streams. Camels are coming in streams. Caravans are coming in streams bearing loads and goods. Number 20, a job gives you a paycheck. A business gives you residual income beyond your director's salary. When you have a job, your salary is fixed. Your paycheck, you already know it. But when it's a business, there's a continuous flow. There is the director's drawing, which you draw as a director or as the owner of the company. I'm not a lawyer, but let me just quickly warn you. Let me please, or rather, encourage you. Don't start a partnership. Start a limited liability company. It may cost you when you are starting, but it protects you eventually. Because if the tax office comes after you, any money in Oni and Sons also belong to Mr. Oni. Any money inside Oni and Sons that is just a partnership belongs also to Mr. Oni. They will tax it as if it is, but if you say, it's my business money, they say, well, sorry, it's still you trading as Oni and Sons, and they will tax it. Number 21, your company can exist continuously even after your death. Your company continues because you put structures, systems in place that helps to make it continue. That is very important. Number 22, through your company, you have the power to enter contracts. You can enter a contract with people because they are signing with another entity. Number 23, your company has the power to hold, to purchase, to convey real estate, personal property, to mortgage, to lease such real estate to anyone you authorize, because it's the company and them. So your business can hold properties, can hold lands, can purchase land, can convey real estate to someone else, can mortgage, give people the opportunity to pay at a certain amount continuously because it's been agreed with a company. Number 24, your company has the power to borrow money when necessary for the transaction of its business, for the exercise of its corporate rights, privileges, and franchises. So when you want to expand, when you want to do things, you can approach financial institutions and borrow. You can approach them to carry out your obligations. Number 25. This one is a very legal one. I'll just read it and move on, because our sister has dealt with it. Your company can reach the point where you also begin to issue bonds to raise money, promissory notes, or even bills of exchanges, debentures, and other obligations and evidences by which you can borrow money payable at a specific time. When you take your company to a level, if they gave you Lagos Ibadan Expressway to do, and you find that you didn't have the funds, and you don't want to just expose yourself to a 30% borrowing, you could go out, ask people to be able to come and buy, to invest in bonds and promissory notes and bills with your company. But they can't do that because you are a good man. They will do it because you have a company that has a track record, that has equity, that has things they can hold on to. Number 26, your company has the power to make donations to public welfare or for charitable, scientific, or educational purposes. That way you are able to bless, you are able to touch lives. We just started a university, and my company decided to create a new foundation through the company called MASS, M-A-S-S, Matthew Ashimolo Scholarship Scheme. And where the business is committed to pay for 40 university students in our own university, in King's University, every year. 40. Of course, I do for a few others, but this is committed to a specific university. A company can do this. And guess what? When the taxman sees that such money is committed for charitable purposes, that one is deducted and no tax is paid on that one, because you are touching lives and making difference. I see somebody's company really exploding after today. I see God bringing you into new levels. There's wealth in this nation. It's coming into our hands. Let me show, okay, I'll get to that. Number 27, a company gives you the power to conduct business, have offices, hold, purchase, mortgage, convey real and personal property in other nations, depending on the law of the land in which you are. So you find that your company can go and take a mortgage, buy property, operate somewhere else, as long as you recognize, respect the laws of that land. Number 28, a company gives you the power to purchase, wholesale, and transfer shares of its own capital stock. You reach a point in your business, like I said earlier, where you need dilution. Other people owning something, company, you have to now sell shares. Because the lawyers will advise you on the amount of controlling shares you need to have so that you are the one who at some in some way influence the destiny of your company, even though others have bought shares in it. Number 29, when you set up a company, the advantage also is that you have the power to decide when to wind up or dissolve such company without being wound up if you are within the law. You can decide, this business is not doing well, I'm selling it. Or this business, I no longer want to run it. One of my companies, in 2006, I think it was, or 7, 9 or 10 years ago, was called Matteson Media. Matteson Media was the number one distributor of Christian literature during the from the days of Buhari to Babangida to Abacha. Foreign exchange was scarce, and I lived in Europe. Publishers approached me. So I became the distributor of Christian literature when books were no longer entering Nigeria. I represented 25 publishing houses as the sole distributor for Kenneth Hagin, Copeland, Harrison House, Honor Books, every other one you can mention. We became the only one. All the booksellers you see in town today were our customers. But then, I don't want to go into some of the jamboree style of Nigerians. Some of them went to the booksellers convention and protested to those publishers and said, we don't want to be buying from a Nigerian company. We want to buy direct from you. So once I saw the handwriting on the wall, I took the same company, brought in a lawyer, took the value of what the company had and used it to bless the lady who managed it. Because I adopted her when she was 11, today she's 51. One of the reasons also why I blessed her was that as she finished youth service as a pharmacist, she never worked for one day with her certificate. All she did was to run Matteson Media. So I could see that I cannot run this company anymore. She might be able to run it well because you become fresh in her hands. You have powers to pass on like we have done. The owner, number 30, the ownership of a company gives you the opportunity to be able to provide employment for the unemployed and solve problems for others. Nigeria is at the crossroad. 60% of our population are under 30. If Nigeria is 170 million people and 60% are under 30, it means we have a very young, upcoming generation who will need work, who will need opportunities, who will need platforms. And it's very interesting. No, I don't know of any Nigerian university that doesn't run teachings on business administration, but there are no businesses to run and administer. So you and I need to own companies. What I'm teaching today, in case you can't write everything, I'll give you the email address, I mean the website address, beg your pardon, or where to buy it as an ebook. The paper book will be out in a few days' time. How do you make your business work? Firstly, you've got to switch from consumer to producer. In other words, if you do not provide a service, you have limited your income and impact. You have to switch in your mind from mindset of the people, from being consumers to being producers. The majority of our people don't think in the sense of producing. They think of consumption. If you are going to make great business in your hand, then you've got to fix a daily rate for yourself when you start your own business. What do I mean? How much are you worth per hour? How much are you worth every day, every week, every month? You've got to improve your daily rate, improve the daily income of your business, but fix a daily rate for yourself. If I want to know my value, I will have to look at what I represent, say KICC. How much is KICC's income? How many hours am I supposed to work legally? That would be 2,000 hours. So whatever KICC's income is in a year, divided by 2,000 equals to what I am worth per hour. Until you do that, you might just find yourself not building any great thing. So you need to fix a daily rate and place yourself on that place where you know, I've got to achieve this. I've got to make this happen. Thirdly, a sacrifice now is important in order to be better later. Many people start business, and I know that Pastor Kwaju is going to ask me questions later, but many people start business, and the next thing, they want to begin to eat the seed and the fruit, and they don't realize that delayed gratification is a sign of maturity. Address and build your mind. Become a better person. Get books, get information. The CDs of today's teaching, because we spoke so fast. Get it played several times. At a point, there will be some serendipity, some sudden discovery as you are listening. There will be some revelation. One day you will, if you refuse to buy the dress today, tomorrow you will own the factory. Can I hear you say amen?
Amen.
If you stay away from that every day, important. The wealthy place. Where is the wealthy place? I mean, it is the geographical location where you see the right kind of people. Psalm 66, verse 12. You've caused men to ride over our heads. We've been through fire and through water, but you brought us out and into a wealthy place. A wealthy place is where you begin to hang with people who are stroking your mind to achieve, stretching your mind, challenging you. Many of you denied yourself of good rest, of your Saturday leisure to be here today. Look for people who are doing something good, if possible. Ask for permission to work for them free for 1 hour, for 2 hours, for a day. Say, sir, I can see you work very hard and you've been an achiever. Can I carry your briefcase for 1 week? And so you study the person's habit. No matter how they try to hide it, at some point it will show. Then you might just find out, okay, this is the area where I need to adjust. This person works hard. I remember flying one time, Likud and Gote. Last cabin of British Airways, leaving 12 midnight. As soon as everyone in the plane had slept. But he didn't sleep. He had notes, he was studying. I'm thinking, at that time he was worth like $10 to $15 billion. Firstly, my first question is, Kilo Nshembi? Ah. $10 to $15 billion. You need to go get yourself some private. I'm sure he had, maybe he was in service. Then number two, what note are you studying? He was going for some meeting. I have to preach 5 a.m. when I mean 8 a.m. when I get to London, or 7 a.m. when I get to London the next day. So I had to sleep. But every time I woke up to go to the bathroom, he was still studying his note. This is the only billionaire in the cabin. All the means, the millionaires were. They were making so much noise. That encounter for me was very major. I saw that the man knew what he did to achieve what he had achieved, and he knew what to do to continue to keep it. Because you have it today don't mean you'll have it tomorrow. Like I told you earlier, I've been in this Nigeria a few years now, 64 years, man. I only know two families out of all the big names we've known that have kept four generations of wealth. Most did not create the platform, the system. There are more teachings in the Bible on finance than on prayer. Yeah, you heard it from me. And I'm the only one who have produced a prayer Bible on earth. The Power of Positive Prayer Bible is the only one. And there are more scriptures on finance. There are 2,000 scriptures on finance. And 500 direct and indirect references to prayer in the Bible. Jesus spoke 37 parables. 23 had to do with economics. And that's 61% of all the stories Jesus told had to do with one subject. 61%. He could have told stories on just about any subject. So you need to move to the wealthy place geographically, mentally, and psychologically. You need to move. You need to begin to see yourself blessed so you can be a blessing. God told Abraham, I will bless you, but that's level one. You will be a blessing. That's level two. And there's a difference. I will bless you is for you. You will be a blessing is when you become a distribution center. There's a difference between the woman out there selling two bottles of Coca-Cola and the one down the road who receives four trailers every week. The one who receives four trailers is a distribution center. God will make you a distribution center. I see blessings coming into your hands. Then you got to find and use your gift. There is no one on earth that lacks gift. We're all gifted. Find your gift. Find your talents. Find your skills. Find your abilities. Find your giftings. Cultivate that gift. Stay close to those who value your ability. Stop surviving. Start thriving. Stop surviving. Start thriving. Thrive with knowledge. Thrive with ideas. Let me bring my teaching to a close by just sharing with you the supernatural results that back you as a believer and that will begin to follow you when you form your own company. Number one, God will put treasures in your hand. Treasures of darkness. Isaiah 45 verse 3. Sealed up treasures. Deuteronomy 32 verse 34. These are in the Bible. And when a thing is called a treasure, it means it is special. I went to see the deputy governor of my state, inviting her and the governor for the grand launching of our university, which we did 2 days ago. And she now reminded me that the last time I saw the governor, like 5 years ago, I gave him he had asked me to pray. He's a Muslim governor, Osun State. And as I was praying, God just opened my eyes and I saw a field of gemstones in Osun State. And he had almost no end. It was black in color. I know there's gold in that state. And I saw that. She now told me, oh, the governor has been telling everyone, Pastor Matthew said there's treasure in this land. And they now brought some specialists from, I think, Australia or Canada. And the guys came, I wouldn't mention which town. And they found that this ancient town is sitting on a gold and gemstone field The only problem is they need to move the whole town. And you trust Yorubas. Agboleta na ma move. The whole town is sitting on a field of gemstones and gold. And the guy said, there's no way. If you want to prosper, they said, there's more deposit here than probably your national, your all treasure. But you got to move the city. You can do that somewhere else. They are about to do that in Zimbabwe because the city of Mutaru is sitting on a diamond field that they don't need to dig. If you want to move me for that one, now money you go take move me. All right, let me quickly finish. Treasures of darkness, sealed up treasure. Deuteronomy 32 verse 34. Treasures of the sand, treasures of kings. 2 Kings 24 verse 13. 2 Kings 24 verse 13. Treasures in the field. Jeremiah 4 verse 18. Treasures of the east. Matthew 2 verse 14. Matthew 2 verse 14 mentions the fact that those wise men brought treasures from the east. Let me teach you something here. When Abraham saw that there would be conflict, he blessed Ishmael and sent him to the east. And the sons of Ishmael hidden treasures. Isaiah 45 verse 3. Isaiah 45 verse 3. And Isaiah 45 from verse 1 to 3 was actually addressed to a Gentile king who believed in prospering when the people of God rejected it. Thus said the Lord to Cyrus, whom I have anointed, to pull down, I will go before you and tear the gates of brass and tear the bars of iron. Cyrus was a Gentile. He decided to make himself available for God when the Jews will not make themselves available for God. And God blessed him, anointed him. A Babylonian record show that he tore down 100 gates of Babylon and conquered Babylon for God. I see you. Amen. Somebody's going to prosper after this. Amen. The idea open them up. Their number, the next one is unstewarded favor. Psalm 102 verse 13. Inheritances. Numbers 26 verse 53, 54. Deuteronomy, your bread warm. Microwave is just a name we call that, but it's bigger than that. But Tesla bumped into it by accident. Unfortunately, because he was an East European immigrant, he sold it cheaply for about $23,000. And people have made about $100 billion with it. Even songs. Just last week, the last rights of Michael Jackson's songs were bought again for billions. Which lands and houses, Joshua 24 verse 13, 1,400 times the Bible mentions lands and houses. 1,400 times. The land that I will give you. The land that I will give you. In other words, God believes in real estate. The only estate that is real estate. The only estate that is real, God with lands and properties in your hands. So we need to start companies. We can make a difference. We can change our world. And I believe that if truly everyone who came to this meeting began to really dream big, the time has come for believers to change Nigeria. And you are the people who will bring that change. Amen. I said you are the people who will bring that change. Amen. Just before I step down or written on finance, this one is 101 sub matters on tithing and so on. 41 blessings that follow when you tithe. It will bless you. Second one is, book two is 50 facts about indebtedness. 30 reasons for lack. and 21 steps to overcome lack. The third book, the next one is Breaking Financial Hardship, 17 Ways to Invest, 22 Insights on Biblical Prosperity. The fourth small book is 10 Reasons for Investing, 35 Ways to Save Smartly, 50 Smart Ideas on Property Investment. I've expanded that in another book. It's now 100 Ideas on Property Investment. This is my favorite book on the Commonwealth Transfer. And then this is one other book, The 10 M's of Money, Making It, Managing It, Multiplying It, Magnetizing It, Using It as a Miracle Money to Serve the Lord, and so on and so forth. It will really bless your life. The last one I mentioned is 33 Irrevocable Laws of Wealth Creation. After we finish all this teaching, you need to obey the laws of wealth creation, or else a person can start a company and it didn't flow. Nigeria doesn't quite have statistics, but in the United Kingdom where I live, 20% of ocean. I pray that yours will really prosper, will increase, and as you have stepped on this holy ground, something will work for you. And it will be well with you. Even before you leave this premises, I pray for certain people here. God will give you creative ideas. God will give you insight. God will show you something you can do. There are people here today, I pray for you, you will make a difference. And I pray for certain people here, you go from local to global. The Lord himself will bless you beyond imagination. Everything you've heard from the various speakers will work for you. In Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. I'll just welcome back again to the podium Pastor Matthew Ashimolo for a brief time of question and answers. All right. You may be seated, sir.
My answers are also
all right. Okay. All right. All right. Before we start, let me just acknowledge the presence of the senior pastor of Holy Ghost Christian Center, Reverend Amos Ifewa. Amen. All right. We just have one. First thing, we want to congratulate you, sir, on the opening of the university.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And second thing we want to do, yesterday was his birthday, so we want to wish him. Can you please bring the cake forward? I'd like everybody to rise to your feet.
Wow.
Amen. You may, no. We have to encourage you. You may want to move it so that it doesn't block the view of it. Just move it aside. Amen. All right.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. You may be seated.
According to sequence, but I'll just share the point.
All right.
Low best time. In other words, a person shouldn't resign suddenly and go start a business. And then you have maybe a time when you have some grasp of technology by which you can connect with the modern world. Say, for example, the median age of people I see in this hall today are mostly young people, and they have access to social media. That is a good time to begin to push
on social media, and also when the business laws are favorable. Right now, business laws in Nigeria, in my opinion, are favorable. Passionate. If you are passionate about selling, I also just 9 to 5 business. You eat it if you want to read. How will I make it available? And then I must say, to do business, making money must excite you. If you are not excited at hearing the jingles of the coins, then don't do business. But if you are excited, yes, of breaking through and seeing the kind of checks your father never saw and making the money your father never made. But that must be at the back of the mind of the person. Even if you are a believer, don't be so spiritual and say, I just want to bless my community. Get real. Make money. Make money. And you must also be ready for a new career, because once the business really takes off, it might be possible that you may have to extricate yourself from where you used to work to now run it.
Thank you very much. Yeah. All right, the second question will be, how do you make the decision on the business area to focus on?
Firstly, you've got to find what is important to you. For me, 2-3 things are important. The dissemination of information. So it made me to go into the world of publishing. And like I told you, I became distributor for 25 book companies for the whole of West Africa. And then I also found that I love to share the things I know, and that has led me to self-publish. Self-publishing is not easy, I remember. I tried to use some publishing houses in the United Kingdom, and they'll give me the word, oh, the world is already full of books. But then when my books began to do well, they now wanted to publish, but I'd already created a platform for the distribution. It must also be something you could do even if they wouldn't pay you. You are excited. Say if a person is a lawyer, they love to fight for justice. They love to stand and argue on behalf of somebody or make something happen. You must be passionate to the point that you could do that thing if they didn't pay you. That level of passion will not make it pay you. And then you must evaluate the business, the risk that the business has before you go into it. Because if you are not ready for the risk level, then maybe it's not your area of focus and you shouldn't go into it. But in another area to focus on, it must be the kind of business you live, breathe, and you...
All right. Now, what survival tips should the new entrant into business hold very dear?
First of all, you have to have a business plan. Many people hear that everyone's registering a company, they are starting a business, and they just go and start. You have to have a business plan, okay? I want to distribute Gary. I want to make it available to many people. How am I going to distribute? What is the guarantee that they'll buy from me? Where would I find the people who want this service? Then be conservative about how long it will take to make profit. Don't say, I just start like that. Before 6 months, money will be rolling in. Before 1 year. This oftentimes has, so even if there's some degree of profit, you were rolling it back in and you were not drawing it. You rather put yourself on a salary. And so the time to also start is when you have put aside some small money in order to not dip your hand into the income that is coming from the business. A person shouldn't just resign tomorrow, I'm starting my own business. He needs to have set aside something he is living on while this business is finding its footing, or else he will create more issues for himself There are people who do not know how to manage customers, and they lose business in the end. Then establish a market before production. Establish a market before production. Don't just sew clothes and say, we sell clothes, and then you sew the thing. You don't know my size. I say, I buy it from me now, man of God. That's blackmail. You need to establish a market first. When I was approached to do the distribution of Christian literature in Nigeria, I was actually approached. I started a business from the age of 14, but I didn't know I would be the one to distribute Christian literature in Nigeria on the level that I did. And we did it up to the north. We had customers coming from as far as Maiduguri. I had to do some research, and I was shocked. The United States had more research on Nigeria when it comes to books, Christian books. Apparently, we are the second largest market on earth. We are the second largest market, second largest consumers of Christian literature. So it just showed me that, hey, boy, this thing will make profit too. So that's, we had information, and then we created the network for distributing it, use night bus, use different things, and publicized.
How do you start a business in a foreign terrain?
Starting business in a foreign terrain, I will suggest that a person must first have their bite on business locally. Number two, having become the language of today, you also need to think global. I love to quote that scripture where the Bible says, and this angel had 1 foot in the sea and 1 foot on land. I see that like intercontinental, international, global business. You need to think global. And when you think global, you need to realize either by or whatever, we all are products of cultures. And in cultural anthropology, they say that we interpret the world from the perspective of the culture we're coming from. So you've got to understand that in order to sell your product to the world, you have to understand the Ghanaian person before you can sell well to him. You have to understand the European person before you can market to him. What is exciting you may not excite him. Global marketing is possible. You've got to understand the market you are selling to. You have to also know how immediately social media. I read the last conference from my office. That is the kind of platform we have today to do global business. You have to know the law, study the market, think global, follow the legal process of that terrain. Of course, that will not be difficult for Nigerians because Nigeria is one of the most difficult places to start a business. In the UK, it takes you 15 minutes to register. You just go online, pay your money. No, not even up to 15 minutes. Go online, pay £15, and within a few minutes, you've registered. In the United States, I registered a partnership within 5 minutes. Walked into an office in Houston, said I want to start a property company. We were thinking of, I think we bought some flats, some apartments in Houston. And we wanted it in the name of the company. I don't want Matthew Abiodun and Ashimolo and those, so that somebody does not go to the US and be doing foreign. And even apart from that, because I carry a British passport, it means I'm taxable globally. So if there's a property in America, it's not difficult for Britain to do a check and say, you have property in America. Have you paid tax on that one? Learn the customs of the people you want to sell to. Understand the political climate and the property laws, particularly if you want to invest. I was shocked when I was in Dubai recently. I hope I wasn't misinformed. But I was told you cannot have freehold. You can only have few years lease if you own the property in Dubai. I guess it's probably because the people of the land are only 13% of the population. And they know that if they allow people to own the freehold, then language barriers should be overcome through translators. And that's why I think our universities need to move into the level where three or four of the global languages need to be taught. Whether you read Yoruba or physics, you should be able to speak maybe Mandarin, which is Chinese, French, which opens the whole of French Africa, French Caribbean, and the French, and some countries in Europe that have some degree of French. Belgium, France itself, Switzerland have some French language, and then, of course, English. That way it gives you a global platform. I mean, they've been able to market their language, so somebody who wants to do business, you know, say, tiwa lama vita, tiwa na adera.
All right. The fifth question is, if I have minimal or no funding, how do I start?
A good number of businesses who had minimal funding tend to start from home. And in fact, in my book, Irrevocable Laws of Wealth Creation, one of the laws I cited there was that it was better you start with minimal than with a lot of money. That way there'll be hunger, there'll be passion, than you giving so much money. If they give you so much money to start, you hire a PA, your PA will hire a PA. Be your own staff for some time. Start from your kitchen, if possible. One of the largest Christian TV stations in the world, God TV, started in the people's kitchen. Convert your personal equipment to company tool. Your telephone should now no longer be just for conversation. Should become an instrument for doing your business. Seek some degree of sponsorship. The founder of the magazine, Ebony Magazine, had $1,000 loaned to him by a friend. And that then became a multi-million dollar conglomerate. Avoid unnecessary expenses. Base your receivables on what will work for you. Work around the clock. That way you build sweat equity into the business. Don't just say we've closed. Don't form that habit. Be the kind who is still mobile with your business. People can get you and let anyone around you understand, look, we are just starting. Let's not begin to carry ourselves as the managing director of this company. And then the last thing I would say, of course, is that you should hustle. Really hustle. It is only when you hustle that your business can do well.
All right. How can one create wealth from a social enterprise?
Most businesses create social enterprises themselves. What I tried to say is this. Most businesses created as a social enterprise were started by another business. If you go out and say, I want to start a social enterprise as a company, number one, your income will be less because it wasn't created for profit making per se. It's a social enterprise. I think in Nigeria in law, it is called a GLE. I'm not very sure. I'm just a pastor. And even the accounting system at the moment, globally, does not yet accommodate or enable that kind of business to show profit. Because once you have profit in a social enterprise, really, you can't declare profit. It has to be put back again to be used. One of our companies, KRCC TV Limited, is a social charitable enterprise, so to say. Any profit it makes is covenanted to KICC. Any money that comes is covenanted to KICC. God gave me the idea to start the television station. We gave some time to KRCC themselves, while KRCC gave us money to start the TV. I'm talking, KRCC is an entity, I'm an entity, you know. So now when people buy airtime, they buy from this company called KRCC TV Limited. KRCC TV, KRCC themselves, for the money they give us, they get about 40% of our airtime. So they're getting more than their money. My counsel have always been that if you are a young person starting in life, I get this all over the place, don't start a charity. Don't start a charity. Don't start a non-governmental, non-profit organization. Make money first. Then you can do that later. If you start a non-profit organization and you come to me, I should give you money, I will struggle. But if you are an achiever yourself, I will come and support what you are supporting. It makes easier.
All right, how will I, as a business person, become creative or develop creativity to grow my business? How do I build creativity?
The first thing I think is the best way to break through is to find a problem and solve it. Wealth is in every nation, but it is hidden behind problems. People who make wealth or who get wealthy are people who found a problem and solved it. It's the easiest way. I'm going to mention the. It seems simple to me, and if somebody runs with it, that's fine. I was in the coast, and I saw a simple idea. That means I'd never thought about it. I don't eat that kind of food. I have. But I saw this advert. They were advertising packaged Gary. That Gary already has sugar inside it. Of Ivory Coast. They call it Gary to go. So first thing comes maybe some business guy or some guy who works in some office. You can buy the sachets in your briefcase. Nobody knows what's in your briefcase. Unless they open your briefcase, of course. You can pour it in the cup, and before they know, you are eating peanut, you are drinking this thing in the cup. Match your creativity, expertise, with the need you observe. There are needs in our nation. Unbelievable levels of need. And there are thousands of businesses that can be started. Find a problem. Solve the problem. In Nigeria today, there are people who are here who probably read counseling, psychology. There are no counseling centers in Lagos. And people have marital issues. They don't know where to go. And not all of them are in the church. Because the church is, at the moment, the only one offering counseling in marriage, etc. But somebody has guidance and counseling as a degree or psychology, is looking for a teacher's job, and is angry that they are not paying him when he could have rented an office, marketed that he is a professional at guidance and counseling. He knows all those theories of Rogerian, Heisenk, and all those ones. There are problems that are looking for a solution. And before the guys come, you let them know it's 2,000 naira an hour. They sat in front of you, or 5,000 naira an hour, and you saw 10 clients or 5 clients a day at 5,000. That's 25,000 naira a day. In 10 days, you have 250,000. And if you only work for 20 days, you have made 500,000 naira. No teaching job will give you that. And it is the same guidance and counseling or psychology that you read. And then in the era of creativity, find a way to create niche memory in people's minds. So every time they remember you, ride the wave with the uniqueness of what you produce, and probably put 15 to 20% of your initial profit into just publicity. 15 to 20% into just publicizing this, your creative idea. As I got here this morning, as I sat down, the ladies in hospitality said, what would you like to have? I said, okay, give me tea. As she was going, I said, what tea do you have? She said, Tetley. And the first thing was, Tetley's advert rang in my head. Tetley makes tea, make tea. I mean, they just, very simple. So do something that will make people not to forget your product. Put 20% of your profit back in marketing. The day is gonna come when word of mouth alone will do most of the job, but put 20% in publicizing. One of the reasons Coca-Cola is always at the front is not because they are sweeter than others, but the amount of publicity, and now they even put your name on it. You know, Joke Cook, Biola Cook. Yes, sir.
Well, you've touched on it. I don't know where you still want to. How do you build an edge in a chosen industry and effectively market the business?
Firstly, you need to think outside the box. Form a habit of out-of-the-box thinking. Don't do things the way your friends have done it. Then find a way to connect with decision makers, enthusiasts, influencers who use social media. If you really want to market your business, look at the various platforms available. Who are the people using social media? How are they using it? What level? How big is it? I believe the church or business needs to use. I have 800,000 followers on Facebook, and I have 70,000 on Twitter. Every day, I don't do it myself, we have a social media department, 10 statements are uploaded from my messages. It has been a draw to either our crusades, our conferences, or any major thing we do. The social media platform is going to explode more. In fact, now it has reached the point where even YouTube has its own TV platform. Take your business, put it at that level. Be shameless with authentic, all-out marketing. Market your product like it's the only one. I mean, you'll be amazed. The best marketers in Lagos are all those guys who sell those funny medicines with speakers on their radio, you know. Their medicine can do all sorts. But those guys, and they know where to go. A lady blesses my parent-in-law a lot. She was in our choir when I was in Nigeria 36 years ago. She started a ministry somewhere called Jakonde, somewhere near, after Okiafa in Isolo. Never been there before. So because of how she blesses my parent-in-law, I accepted to speak for her for 2 days. The crowd in that area. If you go to Abule Egbado, there's a crowd in that area. If you are walking past Medical Road in Ikeja by 8 a.m., I take that route to go to Ewekoro to go and play golf. The crowd in that area. And there's nothing, I don't see many. The only people you see marketing there is those guys with their speakers. They don't have the money to buy airtime on television or radio, but they are very smart. They put the label on all their car, the thing is all over the place. They have dancers in front, and they will be saying their thing. Ben, I think you should add something extra, which the competition does not have. There should be something that makes the competition to say, wow. You have to add something. You see, what makes people recognize or remember you is the extra behind the ordinary. There has to be an extra. There has to be something for which there has to be a wow effect, something that will be remembered. and then combine something unique with what you offer, engage, entertain, and enthrall before you demand patronage and after you have been patronized. Because some people start business, but they don't know that sometimes 20% of your business is going to be repeat business. 20% of your business will be repeat business. I built a house, or rather my company built a house in which I live. It doesn't belong to me. I wasn't around when they were supervising. So the person who helped to supervise brought a plumber who didn't do a good job. When you, it has four rooms. When always in Nigeria, if I'm here, sometimes my wife is not here, sometimes we're here together. Many times, one person will be in the house. And when you flush here, you go to the next room. You saw what you flushed. And you are wondering, do angels go to toilets? I have never called back that plumber since that time because he didn't give a service that says, you know, and then add speed to your delivery. Let it beat your competition. Add speed. Add speed to your delivery so that if others say 30 minutes, you deliver possibly in 20. You create something in the mind of the consumer.
Is it advisable to start a business in a field I'm not an expert in?
Sometimes some businesses have all the indices that they would do well. The best thing if you want to start a business like that, and you know it's not your area of expertise, but you desire to start, number one, employ people who are stronger in that area than you are. Number two, employ people whose area of strength is your area of weakness. I see sometimes people hiring people who are their weakness, and they are the ones having to teach their staff. So why did you hire the guy? Then do not hire relations. Do not hire relations. He just arrived in Lagos, uncle, I need a job, and I know that you have a great job. No, do not hire relations. Do not hire relations. They are not easy to be sacked. They are not easy to be sued. That number two in particular. You want to sue them, your mom will show up. Offer by me. When we started building King's University, we hired a cousin's son. The dad is my cousin. We hired his son as a driver. And the boy would not take instructions from the engineers on site. And he was saying, it's our family's work. They warned him, he wouldn't listen. I came, I warned him, he wouldn't listen. So I came one day and walked him out of the premises and said, you get out of here, pay him his last salary, bye-bye, hasta la vista. Within 2 hours, I had a call from my uncle. That's the man my father follows. Passed on in 2011. I said, hello, sir, kiaburo, re. And I said, he didn't do his job. I said, mo pase fun oni. Ko gba pada. Inside me, I said, e pase ti. I didn't say it out, though. I just told my uncle, I said, with all due respect, you know I honor you and I bless you. No one has taken care of you like I've done. This one, permit me to do what I have done. The boy never came back. I learned a major lesson there. never hire relations. It's very major, and people do not realize. Not even for anything. New business should only hire people also that they know. When you are starting a business, hire people you know, who you know that they can do the work, but you've known them. Partner with people who bring enough resources to the table. Anyone you are hiring must bring something fresh to the table. Then avoid hiring people who are new to the business. They have no clue. You have no clue. Two clueless people. And as much as possible, look for people's drive within your organization. Look for two things. Do they have drive and do they have passion before they desire pay? Some people, it was pay that brought them. You need people who came because they have drive, they have passion. If you find those kind of people, pay them better.
Is it advisable to start a business part-time before I quit my job, or should I quit and focus on business? I think you answered that.
If it is possible, work another job in the early days of your life. In other words, be working and be doing the business part-time. Do not resign suddenly and start suddenly. Very important. Many people have done that and they have had to either run back to the work. Put yourself on salary when that business begins to pay. But before then, if you are working, be part-time in your own business. Before you resign, ensure that this job, this business, can actually pay at least your basic salary on a monthly basis, and can do so for at least 6 months. For at least 6 months. Your financial status is a good indicator of when to go full-time with business. So if you find that also you have some savings coupled with some things coming out of the business you started on the side that you can survive with for 6 months or more, if you now give the business more attention. Then lastly, what are the prospects you see? Are the prospects such that if I resign, oh boy, the business will grow more and I will have more time for it? Because you can resign and find that there's not enough to engage you. There's not enough to engage you. And if you have a family, please don't resign and put your wife and children in jeopardy. It's important to ensure financial security for 3 to 6 months before taking such a step and putting things in place. If it's possible to have paid like 1 year school fee up front if your children are in private education, so that you know that at least for 1 year I'm not worrying about my children's school fee and you are not having to borrow from anyone. Or else you would dip your hand into the capital and then the business begins to reduce.
All right. What are the critical elements to consider in expanding business capacity?
I said when I was teaching earlier on that you need to create adequate space. That's a big challenge for our businesses. Many people want to do business, but all they do is they get $2,000, they run to Dubai, bought a few dresses, they're selling it from their car booths. You need to create space. You need to have capacity to be able to distribute to several people. That is space. Then you need to create volume. You need to probably ensure that you have some monies so that you, at the first stepping out, the volume was big. Then number three, you need to begin to network with people. Maybe you have an Ibadan representative, an Owerri representative, somebody in Kano representative. And you are creating volume, so you have outlets. And then you found a representative in Ghana. And somehow you also found magazines where you can advertise what you are doing. You create volume, you create space, and then run extra shift. change the paradigm of work time. One of the most powerful statements I ever read from Sheikh Al Maktoum, the current Prime Minister of Dubai, in a second book he's just written, not the vision, but there's a second book, something I'd never thought about. And I think even the government of Nigeria should adopt it, is that instead of jobs starting 8, closing 3 or 4, why can't another group take over at 4 and run till night? So if I am dealing with customs, my load is in the wharf. Nigeria is a very funny place. After 3-4 days, your load goes into demurrage, and you can't clear any load in less than 2 weeks. So it's like set up to ensure that your load enters demurrage. Why can't custom have morning shift and afternoon shift? That way you hire another 100,000 people who can work in custom. So you are creating more employment. So this guy's argument, Sheikh Al Maktoum, his argument was that most nations, everywhere closes by 4 or 5. And then they wait till tomorrow again. When we can create a system that runs, and you can have another set of employment, another set of achievement, another set of creativity, and things can just flow like that, the same should be brought into your business. Run it in such a way that you make time, you have extra shifts, you work, you do not close on time, and some things you cannot do yourself, outsource. Outsource some things. Don't be jack of all trades. There are people who have areas of expertise. Don't have your son doing the video while you are the event manager, you are running an event place. Your son has never done a video before. He could lay. I can't do laying in camera. Your son did not know they will open the window, natural light came in and washed out the pictures. Doesn't know how to adjust the iris of the camera. Outsource some things. I hope I answered.
All right. What in your own personal experience, or are the three most important skills for an entrepreneur, business owner, and what is the order of importance?
I heard you say 3, I listed like 10. So I'll just quickly run through. All right. Clarity of vision. You need to know clearly what you want to achieve. Ability to communicate the vision clearly. I am Matthew Ashimolo, being the head of so-and-so place. It is our vision to make this book available in every corner of Nigeria. And until it is in every hand, we shall not rest. We have a clear vision and a clear mission. Then do what you are passionate about. Don't do something you are just enduring. Then, good manager of money and success. Sometimes, some businesses break through, bam, because you found a need in society and you met that need and the money came. But some people don't know how to manage money and they don't know how to manage success. You need to come to a church like this for them to train you in the discipline of managing the money when it comes, so the money does not manage you. And then you need to know how to manage success. There are people whom you can talk to them when they are earning 60,000, when they are earning 600,000, but the first day they saw 6 million, you talk, they will answer back. You know, I guess there's some spirit behind money. You know, my father used to sing a song, all those Akpala songs. He used to say, "Fumi lowo oluwa jowo ninu egbe mi kin le soro ya fanda," you know. I guess his idea was that when people are rich, they can't talk anyhow. Then you have to, so you need to delay your gratification. Delayed gratification is a sign of maturity. Don't buy a 4Runner until you can buy 10. Don't buy a Hummer until you can buy 10. You have nothing to prove to anyone. If somebody's laughing at your jalopy, no problem. The day you will relaunch, they don't know that you are still going to launch. Delay your gratification. Have your monies in estates and investment. Buy land, 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 land. Become a master of one thing or a few things. Don't know everything. Be master of one or a few things. Re-engineer yourself. Reinvest in yourself. Invest in your mind. Invest in your spirit. I have like 20,000 books. I believe in investing in my mind. My staff always complain when they carry my bag to my car. They say it's too heavy. Because the only thing there is two iPads and books. I love to read. I believe in reading 2 books a week so that I stretch my mind. I was born with no information. I want to die with too much information. And then master the art of negotiation. You can never, never prosper in business if you do not know how to negotiate. And listen, because you are believers, anybody who wants to sell anything to you from now on, seek for favor. If they are selling it 10,000, they should sell it to you 9,005. So you got 500 naira of favor. I don't want to do business with anybody who does not show me favor anymore. At this stage of my life, I must have favor. Anybody I encounter for the rest of my life, I must have favor. And I believe because the people who are here today are not just going out to start business. Your business is an extension of the kingdom of God. You are managers of a business ministry. You are ministers of the marketplace. So favor must follow you, just as it followed Joseph. He was favored in the house of Potiphar in spite of what he experienced, and he was favored in the prison. So I believe that should be follow the believer. And then, finally, two finalists. Design your life for success. Create the atmosphere for success. Design your life for success. Stop apologizing for who you are. Dress successful. Look successful. Feel successful. Carry yourself successful. Design your life for success. Don't apologize for being a believer. The time has gone when the emphasis by believers in Nigeria was on the size of the heart and the drabby we look, the better. No. Create the atmosphere of success around you. Do you know there are people who are going to come and do business with you, and the first thing they want to see is the ambience of the business? One guy who is in our building, I told you we have 29 tenants. He said, "Sir, your building has gotten me more businesses." I said, "Well, then pay my rent regularly." And lastly, sell the benefit in your product. Don't sell a product. Don't just say, buy detergent. No. Sell the what is the benefit in this product? So when they gave me tea, and they said, Tetley, then I remember, Tetley makes tea make tea. That was their advert. Tetley makes tea make tea. That's the benefit in their product.
All right. We've heard many stories about focusing on one thing, but we have also observed that most, if not all, billionaires do more than one thing. What are your thoughts on focus and diversity in business?
Focus is a necessity for business success. It's important. A broken focus is the beginning of accidents. A broken focus is a distorted It's the beginning of distorted vision. If the cameras that are focused on us now break, they are distorted. Focus is a necessity. However, on another note, creating other businesses for residual income is wiser. Pushing real estate. Real estate can take 1 year and you didn't see. But next year, the value of the real estate will have really climbed. But you have to eat this year while you are waiting. So you could have other small businesses that are bringing other streams into the house, other streams, other caravans, according to Isaiah 60, verse 6. Other caravans, smaller caravans, something on the side you are doing. You know how to do this, you're doing it on the side. So, but remember, success can make an entrepreneur get distracted as he thinks he is invincible. Therefore, sometimes when you find that your focus is broken because you have too many things, do what Richard Branson had done in the past. He would take a business which he knows that this is not my strength. It is making profit, but it is not that profitable. It could do better with somebody else. They will package it and sell the business to avoid his distraction. As it is now, he only has very limited holding shares in, he only has limited shares in Virgin Atlantic. He sold his Virgin Radio. He sold his Virgin Cola. He also made like Coca-Cola. Anything that sold, that other people sold, he made his own. Even though they still bear the name, he sold it to others. So at a point, anything that will break your focus, you need to find a way to ease it out of your life.
What's your view on family-owned and family-managed business?
Family business could help to generate what I call perpetuated wealth or perpetual wealth. In other words, if my family is involved, wealth can be in that family for a longer period, as long as everybody is trained to do the business. As long as everyone is trained to do the business, perpetual wealth will continue. Family business helps that. It is common among Jews that they pass their business to their children, who pass it to the grandchildren. Ford, the car company, the current chairman is John Ford the Fifth. Even though they no longer hold the controlling shares, yet the Ford family is still holding a major share in the company. The family is still involved. Walmart, at the passage of Simon, I think his name is Sam Walmart, the company declared its value and each person got so much. But one man started the vision that went into billions. Family business has its advantage. Age, however, like I said when I was teaching, I said when you now want to decide who would run the company, age should not be used to determine who runs the company. If I started a company and I'm getting tired or old, it should not be firstborn. It should be the first able. If the firstborn is able, fine. But if it is the secondborn that can run it and make it profitable and everybody will get their own part of the profit, it is better that the first able be put in place legally to run the place than the firstborn run the place down. There have been men who had great names in this nation and they put the business in the hand of firstborn, and today there is a generation who, when you mention their name, they'll say, ah, yeah, I've heard that name that he was once around, he was wealthy. What happened to his wealth? It's gone. Because he gave powers to the firstborn, not the first able. And families, part of the reason sometimes why running business in family is good is that families understand each other. I know the antecedent of my brother knows the antecedent of my sister. I have two sons, and my wife and myself and one are directors now. The other one will come on. I mean, I say it anywhere I go. I have written my will. Everything is passed on to my wife. So if you want anything, you better be good to your mom. Structure is simple when you run family business. It's easy to run. Because the structure is easy. And then there's commitment. Because they know this is ours. If this thing goes down, I'm down, man. You know? But if it's not family, the person can walk away. However, There's a lot of mediocrity in family business. Guy will just come, accountant. Particularly the ones that are not properly structured. Eban, your 200,000. Boys. Family business can be easily targeted by unfavorable governments. In Nigeria, major businesses have gone down because the guy fought the military government in power. And they just say, hey, you're fighting us. You forget that we are government. And they shut down. Central Bank doesn't approve any of his monies. This one doesn't happen. They block everywhere. And before you know, disappears like thin air. Family business. In family business, mediocre performance is sometimes overlooked, which is not good. But on the whole, a family business enjoys the benefits of trusting each other, speed, and solidarity. If you ask me, I will hire my family first before I hire somebody external. However, even though I said I have two sons, one now works in the company, but I put him under somebody who knows better than him. Let him learn the ropes. Because every time you fly people to the top, where else are they going to bring the everything? They bring it down. The only general who hurt David was Joab. Because Joab was not raised in the cave. Joab came as a general. Joab became general on his own time when David said, whoever can kill 100 Philistines and bring their foreskin, I'll make him a general. So Joab did not train, and Joab became a problem to David. He was one who killed Absalom. He was one who gives bad counsel to David because he did not receive the spirit of David. So everyone must start at the bottom up. If your children, let them finish their degrees in Harvard, they need to start in the engine room. Need to start in the engine room.
Thank you very much, sir. I'll just ask that let's all be seated, because if we start moving, he will not be able to go out properly. So I'll ask the protocol officers to please go with our speakers out. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your wisdom. Thank you so much.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, sir. A more resounding round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for Pastor Matthew Ashimolo and Miss Ijoma Uju. And of course, the senior pastor himself, Pastor Poju Oyemade. And another round of applause for yourselves for being a very attentive audience. Very quickly, we'll just have a few announcements and we'll let you have the rest of your day. We will be issuing feedback forms. We'll be sending feedback forms online. So if you registered online or you registered on site today, you will get a feedback form. Please, we ask that you fill our feedback form, and afterwards you'll have access to the materials that were used at today's seminar. Let me also remind you that we have the exhibition stands outside. Please make yourself avail yourself of the exhibition stands, the KICC book stand and the Templar stand. And we would like you also to watch out for our next seminar. It will be on the tax. It will be a tax summit. Watch out for information about the tax summit. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of this seminar. Thank you very much and have a great day.